Good evening, everyone, and welcome to this very, very special Insta class by Amity Online. Today, as you all know, we have a very, very special guest amongst us, the chief badminton, the coach of the Indian national team, Pulela Gopichand. Welcome, sir, to Insta class by Amity Online.
Thank you very much.
Let me just take a minute to just introduce the legend who is amongst us today. Pulela Gopichand, as we know, is the national coach of the Indian badminton team. He's the second Indian ever to win the All England Championship in 2001. Not only has he brought laurels to the country, but also helped coach two of India's Olympic medalists, PV Sindhu and Saina Nehwal. He is the proud recipient of the Arjuna Award, the Dronacharya Award and the Padma Bhushan in 2014. He has been the national champion for 5 years in a row and won a silver at the 98 Commonwealth Games. He founded the Gopichand Badminton Academy, which has helped produce some of India's top badminton players like PV Sindhu, Saina Nehwal, Arundhati Pantavne, Arun Vishnu, Srikant Kidambi, just to name a few. That's just some of his achievements. So, we would like, you know, without any delay, we would like to introduce our special guest and let him talk about his pursuit of purpose, which has helped him achieve so much in such a short span of time. Over to you, sir. So we'll begin by, you know, knowing we want to know, how has your journey been so far? Like your life's purpose, how has your journey of pursuing your purpose been? From being a badminton champion to a mentor and now, you know, running the Badminton Academy. So please tell us about it.
Well, good evening, everybody. Thank you very much for having me. For me, the way you sounded it, it almost like purpose. And for me, it was just that I started to play because it was fun. I was fortunate that my parents were supportive. I was also fortunate that we lived very close to the stadium. Probably had we lived far, we probably wouldn't have joined. I went to join for cricket. Somehow cricket admissions were not available. So parents decided that we go to badminton because tennis they felt was a bit of an expensive sport. So the very reason why I took up the sport was not to make it into a career or something, but was to play and have fun. Because I broke a few window panes and my neighbors were unhappy with that. They complained to my mother. I had sunstroke every summer. So I would just get, every day I would go and come back late in the evening when the light was down. And I always had bruises on my knees because I was falling down playing when I was 10, 11, 12. And then my mother and father decided he's spending so much time on playing. Why doesn't he go to the stadium? So when I was born, it was not that I wanted to be, when I was starting to play also, it was not that I wanted to be a champion or wanted to take this as a career. But I just thought that it is, when I played it with a lot of love and passion for the sport. I really liked the sport, so it made the hard work much easier. It almost felt as though studies was hard work, but playing sport was never hard work. And going in the early days, whether it was 7th, 8th, 9th, when everybody was trying to get to be an engineer, it was also the same route for me in the sense I also wanted, my parents made me join a maths, physics and chemistry subjects in then intermediate, which was 11th and 12th. To write an exam for engineering, which was the normal norm in the 90s that everybody should become an engineer. And that's also the case with me. My life was made difficult because my brother went to IIT. So standards at home were pretty high. So, but luckily I wrote the exam. In some sense, I failed the exam. And I got this year to play badminton. And that year was important because my parents kind of said, if you play well, then you could continue this as a career. In that year, I actually won the junior nationals, went on to play for the country, and more importantly, got a job in Tata Steel. And that actually cemented my career path for badminton. Even before I got a job or was sure that this would be a career, I would played with a lot of passion. I hated to lose. I thought that if I needed to beat my opposition, I needed to work harder than them. So if they went to the stadium at 6, I would reach there by 5:30. If they went, came to the stadium and left it around 7:30, I would hang on for another 10 minutes to play a little more. I would do ball practice at home. I would push myself, went from district to state, state to national. And the same principle worked. I needed to work harder than my opposition. And somehow I got the results at each stage. And every stage I went, I realized that the next level is possible. And that actually made this journey very exciting, because I never thought that I would go this far. But every time I went to another step, I just thought, oh, the next one seems to be possible. And that for me was really, what do I need to do for that? And I started to plan for that, and went from district to state to national to the international level. And I've been fortunate, had a bunch of people who were supporting me, had coaches who were there. And I was able to learn a lot. I was able to read a lot, experiment on myself, and made my career as a player. When I made my career as a player, I realized that it's possible, if it is possible for me to become a champion, I just felt that many others could, because it wasn't so difficult. But the fact was that I didn't have the right knowledge or the right formula. But when I, on the path to becoming an All England champion, I realized that I had the path or the formula with me, but I didn't have the body with me, because by 2001, I had 3 surgeries on my left knee. And in 2002, the final straw was I had another knee surgery on my right knee this time because of overuse, and multiple fractures on my right foot. So it was like I knew what needs to be done, but I didn't have the body to use it. And so I decided to coach young kids. And that's how the Pulela Gopichand Badminton Academy came into being. So it was almost like I had this great formula which I had, or I kind of found out. And then I was like, I wish I knew this when I was younger. And I just didn't have the body to use that. So I found young kids around who were playing in Hyderabad at that time, and started the Gopichand Academy. And the results are there, whether it's the players who won the World Championships or the Olympics. I think there are a bunch of medals. So it's been really a true journey for me, which was... which is not really planned, but every step I took, I thought that the next step is possible. And that's how step by step I'm here. For me, many of you are very young. Many of you are probably at a startup stage in your career. Many of you are in different jobs or studying to do something. Some of the things which I have felt is that it's very, very important that we love what we do, or in a better sense, whatever we do, if we love, then I think we'll be better off. For me, as a career, I love to play. And when I finished playing, coaching wasn't a natural extension to my playing career. It was almost that I could see young talent. And I almost felt that if not me, who? And that's how I took this job up as a coach. Because all your life as a player, and I remember 1985 onwards, I would get up every day at not later than 5. Most of the days it was 4:30, because I would get up at 4:30 in the morning every day from 85 onwards. So almost when I finished playing the career 20 years later, around 2004, I almost felt, or many of us who were playing felt, that we should relax and let us enjoy, because we've really worked hard for 20 years. That's what the mindset was. But then if you have a real purpose, then those things needed to move. And for me also, it was the same. because as an All England champion, you're signing autographs, you're kind of there giving photographs to people. But then setting up of the academy, and as management guys, you would know, was another totally different ballgame. Because suddenly, from being an introvert who didn't want to meet people so much, you had needed to go take appointments, meet people, make presentations, tell them your vision, and ask them to fund you for the academy. It wasn't happening so easily. So it was a tough job. I almost thought, in a sense, that a nice suit, jacket, and a presentation would fetch you money. But life wasn't like that. So I had to go through a lot of rejections before I finally could make it. It was quite a tough, I wouldn't say depressing, but a tough time in my life, where all my entire savings were put up. My house I had to mortgage to finally set up the academy. So when you are pursuing something, I almost can definitely say that nature or God will test you to the point where you put all your resources into one, and you need to jump, or you need to believe that concept or that idea, and then make that plunge into it before you can receive the best results. So I think it's a tough choice, but I think we have to walk that path. We cannot play it safe. I'm not saying make decisions which are crazy and do things which are unreasonable. But somewhere, if your purpose is there, I think it's important that you need to believe and go all the way to achieve it, rather than thinking of many things at that point of time.
Absolutely. So, you know, it's been an incredible journey for you. And, you know, we know that you know, like you mentioned, you've had to face a lot of hardships, a lot of failures. Not every day was same for you. You had, you know, all kinds of circumstances to deal with. So how important it is to, you know, not succumb to failures and to, like, you know, overcome. We, especially now in today's times, we are caught up in a lot of struggles, and we know we face, we face failures, and then we, you know, get bogged down. So how important it is to, you know, not be succumbed by it, to thrive on it and come out successful. So if you could, you know, just give some, what is your mantra of facing failures and overcoming obstacles?
Well, I think the idea of failure itself, we need to really look at. And for me, I would lose a lot of matches, and people today also remember me for the wins. You read out a few of my wins, but you kind of ignored the majority of the losses, and that's how life is. And the sense, we all, when we write our CV, we don't write what we have missed out, we write what we have achieved. So I think very important that failure should not be taken so seriously that it impacts our success. So it's very important that we take these things, and I'm not saying this from a book or something. I'm just saying in my own life, every time I failed, I was feeling very bad, but I would sulk and take my book, cry, stay quiet, stay locked up. But when I came out with a plan. And I think that is what failure should be, in the sense it should be a reason for us to introspect and ensure that we come back stronger. And that would be very, very important. When I went to Germany, I was playing in Germany, and none of our coaches in India actually mentioned this to me. They would always ask me if I lost a match. They would say, what happened? Why did you lose? And the general tendency is that you kind of tend to become a bit defensive. You kind of are like, oh, sir, I lost. Maybe the light was in my eye. The shuttle were fast. I wasn't training well, or court was slippery. My knee was hurting. Some kind of an excuse. Because we don't accept failure, or we don't recognize it. And when I went to Germany, I had this coach called Suyen. And Suyen actually, after one of my losses, and this is like September, October, so it's pretty cold there. I had already had 3 knee surgeries. My knees were getting painful, swollen. in the cold, and I lost this match in Netherlands in the first round, and I was like almost crying, sobbing. And he called Oliver, my other friend from Germany, who's now a coach in Austria. He called him and he said, tell Gopi it's not how hard he falls or how many times he falls. It's how quickly you get up. That is what all that matters. I think that was very, very important for me, because what he said on that day about failure was motivating. And even today, that for me is the most important thing. You kind of go from failure to failure with enthusiasm, and learning is what success is. And we need to recognize that to fail at the higher stages is what life is about, in the sense to go there. See, when you play a district championship or a state, you just have 50 people, 100 people. You play nationals, there may be 1,000 people. When you play international, there's 10,000 people. And with this, like you play at the Olympic level, there are a billion people or more watching or thinking about it or impacting. So that is what it is, in the sense. And you fail at that level, people will call you a failure. But the success is you getting to that level. So I think it is very important to recognize failure, because I have seen people who don't want to fail, so they don't compete.
Right.
I think you take it to the other extreme. So you want to be prepared for going to the matches, but if you fail, you take it in your spirit, come back with a plan, and bang, again and again and again. I think that's very, very important.
Absolutely. I totally agree. So, as you rightly pointed out, that it's not about failing, right? Failure happens. It's everybody experiences failures. It's about how fast and how well you get up and, you know, go on and, just do your thing and achieve your goals. So with that, I would like to ask you, you know, we have a lot of young members at Amity University online, right? And so is there any kind of message that you would like to give to the youth members here at Amity University online? Because, you know, they are young minds, having a bright future. So what is that one thing, or, you know, that again, that mantra to stay calm and to, you know, not be succumbed and move on and be positive? What do you want to tell us, our audience and our students here?
Well, one thing is, as you said, youth, new generation. I've played Olympics in 2000. And when we went to the Olympics in 2000, we had, say, 80 members in the team. We all played, but not many of us, or 90% of the team, did not even believe that they would win anything. So we went there happy to take photographs, collect pins of memorabilia, and come back. That's how the mindset was. So we wanted to be part of the opening ceremony, the closing ceremony, and that's how the generation was. Today, when people went to Rio, although we didn't win any medals, everybody went there to give their best performances and win. And when they lost, we lost many, but they were all unhappy about the losses. Nobody wanted to stay for the opening or the closing ceremonies in that sense. All they cared about was their performance and their matches. So today, what I see is a lot of zeal, a lot of power, a lot of confidence, and wanting to achieve something. That is something which I think the younger generation is wanting to do, which is fantastic. The one thing I would say is patience. I think as much as hard work is important, working is important. It's important to work for long periods of time. It's just not enough. Life is not a sprint. It's more like a marathon. It's sprint, recover. It's almost like an interval kind of a thing. You need to have a lot of intensity. You could push it sometimes, but then you need to relax, regroup, and then push again and again and again. And I think it's important that you do that. So for me, this one point would be very important. As young people, I think when you're young, gain a lot of knowledge. It's very important. The second thing is, when you're young, and this is very important, build relationships. When you're doing business, also money doesn't matter. Build relationships, build reputation. I think people need somebody whom they can trust. and you should be that go-to person. I think that's very important. So like we as coaches or leaders, I say it, and it's true for every kid, every student, I would think, is that you need to actually build a reputation, and you need to be kind of, people should say, this person will not do this. And I think that is important. That trust would be very, very important. So all of you, I think whatever you're chasing, if you don't get it in this quarter or this financial year, it's okay. But if you invest in your reputation, invest in your things which people will identify you with. And as a leader, you don't have a choice of failing. You cannot make a mistake. So be guard your reputation with a lot of effort so that people will remember you for the right things, and they will call on you when it's needed.
Absolutely. So the, you know, the secret of success is patience, determination, and never give up attitude, like you all, you know, you mentioned clearly. So you know, as you're talking about
one of the things, because when you talk about patience, hard work, determination, these things sound like the very dry things. If I were to get up in the morning every day and do determination, hard work, sacrifice, I just don't think I will do it ever, forever. And when you talk about being intense all your life, it's about passion, love, involvement, fun. I think we need to make those as the primary elements. And at some points, there has to be the grit, the determination, the hard work. But every day morning, if we are getting up, pushing ourselves, it's not going to be fun. So I think it's very important that whatever we are choosing, we need to find a higher purpose for it. And sometimes money may not be the singular way of pushing ourselves. So I think if you believe in a product, if you believe in helping others, because for me, the thing was that I could see young kids every morning, and I am at the stadium. I was for the longest period of time. I remember I would get to the stadium at 4:15 in the morning and get up at 3:30. It wasn't a strain for me at all, because I saw the love and affection of the players, and I saw that my contribution to them will make them blossom. So for me, it was easy. But if the same thing was that I would get up in the morning and think of it as hard work and a goal, I don't think I would have continued that for maybe 20 years. So I think it's very important to recognize that fact and take it into consideration that this is an important thing.
Absolutely. So, you know, hypothetically speaking, you know, we have a lot of bright minds at Amity University Online, you know, from, we have MBA students, we have MCA students, and all kinds of verticals. So if you have to, you know, go back to your student life and had to choose, you know, one course that you could do from Amity University Online, what would that be and why?
I think for me, today, general interest is history and nutrition and physiology, but also of interest on the management side, because as a person, I know what I want to get done. When you want to get it done, it's best you do it yourself. That's how it has been. And so I have turned into from a player to a coach to an administrator to an event manager to a lot of things which I was never really trained in that sense. But I think the requirement, you have to mold yourself with it. So for me, from a management perspective, I think sustainable models, how to create sustainable models, is something which I would really love to read or study about. And if I had an option, that's the subjects which I would pick up in management.
That's great. And you know, I just want to know, since, you know, you have a tight schedule, I would like to know, what are the preparations for the Tokyo Olympics, and where do we see? So how many wins do you predict for India this time?
Well, we've been lucky, thanks to the government of India. We have personal coaches, physios and trainees for all of the people who have qualified. We have Sindhu, who's been training with a Korean coach called Park Tae-sang, and a trainer called Srikant, and a physio called Evangeline. We have Sai Pranit also training with Agus and Raju, and Satwik and Chirag training with Bo, and Johnson, Sumanch, and Ganesh. So we've kind of have this great support from the government of India, and all of the players have really pushed themselves. They really worked hard. They leave tomorrow morning. I hope that all of you cheer for us, all of you play and wish as well, so that hopefully our players can come back with some great results.
Absolutely. We are all, you know, we are very excited for the Olympics, and we are sure this time again, we will definitely make history. So at Amity University Online, we really thank you for this session. It was very insightful, and I'm sure the students must have got the success mantra from the man himself. Thank you so much, sir, for joining us today, and all the best for all your future endeavors and the Olympics. Thank you so much. Thank you, Neha.
I actually had one question where somebody had mentioned to me about one of the super tech companies which was on the chat. So I'll just mention it to you that I've not endorsed any such thing. When I knew about it, I walked out of it, and I'm very careful that I do not endorse anything which I'm not comfortable with. And this is something which I thought I'd share, because this was a question which was there on the chat. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you.